What in the world is the Feast of Tabernacles, the birthday of Christ, the water libation ceremony, and Judgment Day all have in common? Well, we're going to find out. My friends, stick with me through this broadcast, because as we go through the last feast day of the year on God's calendar, we're going to uncover some incredible things. So stick with me right after this. Hello, everyone. Welcome back. I'm Jim Staley, Passion for Truth Ministries, and welcome to today's broadcast, where we are diving deep into the scriptures to uncover some amazing prophetic connections into the fall feast of the Lord, the Feast of Sukkot. It's the seventh feast day of the year. I have so much information on my website, on this YouTube channel about that. Just go over to our playlist and find the playlist on the fall feast of the Lord, Sukkot, and you'll be amazed at how many hours that you could dive into this. There's so much that God has given us, and we've not even scratched the surface. I've been teaching this for over 20 years, and every year I still find something amazing. And today is not going to be any exception. So stick with me today. We're going to dive into the deep end and really find out what God has to say and how Yeshua Jesus fits into all of this and how it relates to us today. So before we do that, please make sure you're subscribed to this channel if you're not already. If you love diving into the scriptures from a Hebraic perspective and discovering what the Bible actually says from the Jewish perspective of the early Christians that were authors of the Bible, then yes, this is the channel for you. How we fit spirit and truth together, that's what we're after here. We're not after persuasive words. Like Paul said, we're after the presentation of the power, the demonstration of the power of God. So when we combine the truth with the Spirit, out comes the image of the Father, and the power follows that. All right, so let's dive in and discover a little bit more about what the Feast of Sukkot is all about. It's an amazing feast. Hands down, it's my family's favorite feast. We do this every single year for 8 days. We rent out an entire Christian camp, and hundreds of people come with us from all around the world. But if you want a cheat sheet right off the bat, I can tell you right now, if you want a cheat sheet, and maybe you don't have time to watch this entire program, but you want to learn more about the Feast of the Lord, you can do several things. You can text the word Sukkot, S-U-K-K-O-T, PDF, to 844-763-9543, and you'll get an automatic free download for that. Also, we have available one for trumpets and Yom Kippur. So if you're interested in a free PDF about the Feast of Trumpets, type trumpets PDF to the same phone number on your screen. And as well, if you want one on Yom Kippur, type atonement PDF. That's atonement PDF, and you'll automatically get a free download. So the number will be on your screen. Just text that, and you'll automatically get a free download on all of those. If you want one on all seven feast days, type the word feast day. There you go. You got four ways to get free stuff by typing those words to 844-763-9543, and that'll be your cheat sheet, and you can pass it around to your friends as well. All right, here we go. First of all, let's go to Leviticus chapter 23. I want you to see this, my friends, in real time, because there's so many people that believe that these feast days are Jewish. They're not Jewish by any stretch of the imagination. It's only mainly the Jewish people that keep them today. And so by that definition, we say, or that perspective, we say, oh, they're Jewish. But in reality, all the Christians kept these early on in the first couple of centuries before they were outlawed by the Romans, by the Roman Christians who ended up starting the Roman church, which we call Catholicism today. But if you go past Catholicism, past the church fathers, all the way back to the first century, all of the early Christians, including the Gentiles, kept these feasts. These were just God's calendar, folks. And here's the proof of that. If we go back to Leviticus chapter 23, which is the chapter that outlines the feast days of the Lord, it says right here, "And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel and say to them, these feasts of the Lord, these are not Jewish, which you shall proclaim to be holy convocations. These are my feasts." Do you see that, my friends? Yeshua, God, Yahweh, says these are my feasts. These are not anyone's feasts. These are not even the feast of Israel. These are my holy convocations. And if you go all the way back to Genesis, let's just do it real quick. So if you're brand new to this channel, you've never seen anything before of my teachings on this, let's just go to Genesis chapter 1 and go down to verse 14. Let me show it to you. You won't believe this if you've never seen this before. It says, then God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heavens to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons. My friends, this word seasons is not spring, summer, winter, fall. It's moedim. And the word moedim literally means an appointment, a fixed time or season, specifically a festival. That's what it means. So God gave us these feast days on his calendar and set the sun, moon, and the stars in place so we would know exactly when to meet with him. Like setting a date with your wife to meet you at your favorite restaurant on your anniversary, that is how special these are to him. And the Feast of Sukkot is the greatest of all the festivals. It is the harvest festival of ancient Israel. It's like our American Thanksgiving in a way. It is the marriage supper of the Lamb in Revelation, my friends. It is an extraordinary time. So what I want to do is I want to go right over to Leviticus chapter 23 again, and we're going to read about 10 verses that give us the instructions on the Feast of Tabernacles and show you how this is prophetically lining up with what God has called us to do today and how we're moving towards the end of time, and maybe something might point blank us right in the face. Let's go to it right now. Leviticus chapter 23, verse 33. Let me pull the scriptures up. There we go. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the children of Israel, saying, the 15th day of the seventh month shall be the Feast of Tabernacles for 7 days to the Lord. On the first day, there shall be a holy convocation. What's a holy convocation in today's language? It's a church service. That's it. Everybody gets together. It's time for church. You shall do no customary work on it. It's a high Sabbath. For 7 days, you shall offer an offering made by fire to the Lord. On the eighth day, you shall have a holy convocation. So the first day and the eighth day are Sabbaths. They are days of rest. So those are the days that God's people come together and they have an assembly. On the eighth day, you shall have a holy convocation. You shall offer an offering made by fire to the Lord. It's a sacred assembly. You shall do no customary work on it. These are the feasts of the Lord, which you shall proclaim to be holy convocations, to offer an offering. So we're to bring something before the Lord. This is why God says, do not come before me empty-handed. Be prepared to bring an offering. So the Feast of Sukkot is our end times gathering, Thanksgiving, offering to the Lord for everything that he's done over the past year. It's a sacrifice. There's drink offerings, everything on its day, besides the Sabbaths of the Lord, which are every single week on Saturday, besides your gifts, besides all your vows, and besides all your free will offerings, which you should give to the Lord, this is what I want you to do. I want you to bring an offering to me during the Feast of Tabernacles, something above and beyond. Can I just say something here? Do you know what happened 2,000 years ago during the Feast of Tabernacles that was above and beyond the gift that God gave to all mankind? You know what it was? It was his son, Jesus the Christ, Yeshua, who was born in Bethlehem, Beit Lehem, the house of bread in Hebrew. That's right. If you didn't know that, he wasn't born on December 25th during Christmas. That's made up. That comes directly out of paganism. That was the birthday of the sun gods of Egypt and of Rome. But the birthday of Christ was during the Feast of Tabernacles, where God tabernacled among us. And that's why the scriptures say so. If you're interested in learning more about when Jesus was really born, click the link on your screen and you'll learn everything that you ever wanted to learn about when Jesus was born. So much information on that. Also, on the 15th day, let's go back to the scriptures here. Of the seventh month, when you've gathered in the fruit of the land, you shall keep the feast of the Lord for 7 days. On the first day, again, he's reiterating, there should be a Sabbath rest. And on the eighth day, it's called the eighth great day. By the way, in the scriptures, the Feast of Tabernacles, one of the prophetic amazing things about this is it's an eight-day feast, but really it's 7 days because the eighth day is separate. It is the eighth great day of the Lord, and it's part of the Feast of Tabernacles, but it's separate. And the reason why it is that way is because it's prophetic to the 7 days of creation, which are connected to 1,000 years per day. So the 7,000 years of mankind, 6 days of creation for man. The seventh day was a Sabbath rest in the garden. In the same way, there'll be 6,000 years of mankind. And then there'll be 1,000 year millennial reign of Christ. We will rule with Christ for 1,000 years. And then after this 1,000-year reign is the eighth great day. That's the day when God will make a new heaven and a new earth. The new Jerusalem will come down, and it will be absolutely incredible, probably better than it ever was meant to be from the beginning, because the devil will be chained up, thrown in the lake of fire, and obliterated for eternity, never again to bother us. And so you can see already the Feast of Tabernacles, just in how many days it is, what it's set up for, how it is the redemption of all us back in the day. In Bible times, in the Torah times, they would sacrifice 70 bulls, one for each of the nations. The Feast of Sukkot was all about redeeming the nations, God's people from every tribe and tongue. Does that sound familiar? That's why this is the marriage supper of the Lamb. This is when almost every Hebrew wedding of ancient times would wait till during the Feast of Tabernacles to get married, because this was the bridal chamber moment where Rosh Hashanah or Yom Teruah, the Feast of Trumpets, we learned was when the kings of Israel were coronated. And that's when they became king, and every knee would bow and every tongue would confess that that king was Lord. Sound familiar? And then 10 days later, during that 10 days, you have the 10 days of awe. That's when the wrath of God is poured out on mankind. And then you have Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement that we learned last week. The Day of Atonement is Judgment Day. But after Judgment Day, God's people are now vindicated, and there is a redemption and a party for a redemption from all of the nations where God is grabbing his people from here and there and everywhere. And this is when it begins. This is the marriage supper of the Lamb. Is makes sense. Happens at the end time harvest festival of God. So every single year, our family and millions of Christians around the world, not to mention tens of millions of Jews, are celebrating the Feast of Tabernacles. Why? One, God said so. And two, it's an incredible prophetic connection and a rehearsal for the wedding of our Lord that's coming. All right, let's go back to the PowerPoint and dive in a little bit deeper. First of all, if you're not familiar with what a sukkah is simply a temporary dwelling place. It's a tent. And this is another prophetic connection for us as believers in Christ. Why? Real simply, we're a temporary dwelling place. That's exactly what we are. We are the temporary dwelling place of God in our souls right now. Where remember in Acts chapter 2, the Holy Spirit came down in the form of fire, tongues of fire over the individuals, the disciples that were there. The reason why it was there, the tongues of fire, is because there was a fire, pillar of fire over the Holy of Holies in the tabernacle of Moses, and the tabernacle was being moved from the temple to the inside of a human being back to where it originally was in the garden, and the pillar of fire is the designation marker for that, that the Holy of Holies is now inside of us. We are the tabernacles of God, ladies and gentlemen. And also, Yeshua himself is our tabernacle. He's the one that covers us, right? He protects us in this crazy world that we're in. And also, I mentioned this also earlier, it's when Yeshua himself was born, okay? Now, I want to get to something very, very, very exciting. It's not talked about very much within the Feast of Sukkot or Tabernacles, but it is no question the most powerful part of the Feast of Tabernacles is the water libation ceremony. The ancient water libation ceremony was so popular that the Talmud, which is Jewish writings in the 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th century that were written down, the oral law of Moses was written down. And this is what the rabbi said about the water libation ceremony. They said, "One who has never witnessed the rejoicing at the place of the water drawing has never seen true joy in his life." And as I share this with you and go through a little bit of details, I think you're going to recognize why. First of all, every morning during the Feast of Sukkot, they would go down to the Pool of Siloam and they would draw water from the Pool of Siloam. Now, the Pool of Siloam, or some people are familiar with it as the Pool of Siloam, was crazy important. It was a one-acre pool, as I shared with you last week, that you would go down into it, you would take your clothes off, you down to your undergarments, you would get immersed completely in the water, all the dirt goes away, you come up on the other side, ritually pure, they give you a brand new white robe, and you climb the stairs up to the Temple Mount. Now, what's fascinating about this is that water was the water where Jesus heals the blind man. This is it. This is that pool, okay? This pool is the pool that was the cleansing pool before you met God. So every morning they would take water from this pool. They would climb all the way up to the Ophel, up to the Temple Mount, up to the altar. And then there was something absolutely incredible tradition that happened. There were two grooves that went down the side of the altar. One was for the water and one was for the blood. During this feast day, they would take water and they would take wine, and they would take the water from the pool of Siloam and the wine, and they would pour it down the altar simultaneously, and they would reach to the bottom of the altar. There was a bowl, and the water and the blood went into the bowl together, and they mixed. The water and the blood together is what brings freedom. Watch this, my friends. Turn with me to John chapter 19, verse 33 and 34, and you'll see this incredible connection. When they came to Jesus, now he's on the cross, they saw that he was already dead. They did not break his legs, but one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. Now, this is amazing because out of the side of Christ, who was the altar, all right, came blood and water, and the blood and water flowed together. It's the blood and water that causes us to be cleansed. It can't be just the blood only, and it can't be just the water only. It must be the water and the blood together. The life is in the blood. That's the blood of Christ. The water itself is the cleansing agent. It's the water of the word. That's what it symbolizes. And we see an incredible story in the Torah of a commandment of how to cleanse a leper. And I want to show you that right now, because if you've not ever heard it, it will absolutely give you an appreciation for the Torah in a way that maybe you've never seen. Watch this, ladies and gentlemen. All right, let's go over to Leviticus chapter 14. I'll show you this. This is the cleansing of the leper. This is amazing. Let me show you how it's related to Sukkot. All right, let's read the first 8 verses. Follow along with me. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "This shall be the law of the leper for the day of his cleansing. He shall be brought to the priest, and the priest shall go out of the camp, and the priest shall examine him. And indeed, if the leprosy is healed," now remember, the priest is representative of Christ, "the priest shall examine him. And indeed, if the leprosy is healed in the leper, then the priest shall command to take for him who is to be cleansed 2 living and clean birds, cedar wood, scarlet, and hyssop." Right there, ladies and gentlemen, we have the entire elements and the components at the cross. The cedar beam that was on his shoulders. We have the scarlet that's there as the scarlet robe. We have the hyssop that they put to his lips. This is messianic all over the place. And then we have 2 clean birds. So watch how this works. "The priest shall command that one of the birds be killed in an earthen vessel." So we've got Christ and we've got us. Those are the 2 birds. "One of the birds to be killed in an earthen vessel over running water." So there is the blood and water right there. He's killed over running water in a bowl. "As for the living bird, he takes it," the cedar wood, the scarlet, the hyssop, takes all of them, every element of the cross, and dips them, it says, "into the blood of the bird that was killed over the running water. He shall sprinkle it 7 times on him who is to be cleansed from leprosy, shall pronounce him clean, and shall let the living bird loose and go free in the open field." Do you see that, my friends? We are the living bird. Christ, the pure, perfect dove, gave his life for us, was wrapped in cedar wood, scarlet, hyssop, and then we were dipped into the water and the blood of his death. And because of that, we are set free in the open field. Look at that. That is an amazing connection that we can make to the blood and the water all the way back in the book of Leviticus and connect that to the Feast of Tabernacles. That is amazing, in my opinion. All right, now let's continue because we're just still in the water libation ceremony, and we've got another thing that happens. So not only did they take the water and they poured it down the side of the altar, and the wine that goes there, of course, that represents the blood. But we have in John chapter 7, verse 37-38, it says this, and it's talking about the last great day, the eighth great day of the Feast of Tabernacles. On the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, "If anyone thirst, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture says, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." Now, because most of us Christians have not grown up on God's calendar, and we've been keeping a Catholic calendar all this time, that has really defrauded us, in my opinion, of the depth and the beauty of these feast days that God built as a curriculum to teach our children the way that we should go. But we don't recognize these unbelievable nuggets that I'm about to show you, as we just read right past it. We don't even know what feast he's talking about, right? I've read this 1,000 times when I was younger, had no idea what he was talking about. What do you mean? What's the eighth great day? What's the last day? Who cares? I'll tell you why. Because if you know a little bit about Jewish culture in the first century, what you know is they read Isaiah 12 every day of the feast. Everyone in Judaism of the first century, every Israelite knew Isaiah 12 backwards and forwards. Why? Because they heard it every day at the Feast of Tabernacles. And on the last great day, right after the water libation ceremony, Yeshua, Jesus, stands up and he says, on this day, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture says, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Why is that so important? Why is he saying this? Well, we got to go to Isaiah chapter 12 to find out. And when you see this, you're going to have a whole new appreciation for why he said what he said. Let's go there. Isaiah chapter 12, this is what they just read. Imagine them, the rabbis, just reading this entire chapter, and then Yeshua stands up and says what he says. And that day you will say, "Oh Lord, I will praise you. Though you were angry with me, your anger is turned away and you comfort me. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For Yah, the Yahweh, is my strength and my song. He has also become my salvation." Now here, the word salvation here in Hebrew is the word Yeshua. It's Jesus. It's Yeshua in the Hebrew, which literally means salvation. So think about what they are saying, my friends. Behold, God is my Yeshua. I will trust and not be afraid. Yahweh is my strength and my song. He has also become my Yeshua. Think of the prophetic implications of what they're saying. Therefore, with joy, you will draw water from the wells of Yeshua. And in that day, you'll say, "Praise the Lord, call upon his name, declare his deeds among the people, make mention that his name is exalted, sing to the Lord, for he has done excellent things. This is known in all the earth, cry and shout, O inhabitants of Zion, for great is the Holy One of Israel in your midst." Oh my goodness, my friends, I don't think you could pull this together and make it any more exciting. Literally, this entire chapter, which they are reading during the Feast of Tabernacles, during the water libation ceremony, where they're literally saying, "Yahweh has become my salvation. Let us drink from the well of Yeshua. For great is the Holy One of Israel that's in our midst." And Yeshua just happens to stand up right at that time and say, by the way, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture says, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." You see, Yeshua is connecting himself to the pool of Siloam. He's the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father, and the Temple Mount represented the Father. No one comes up those stairs without going through the pool of Siloam and being cleansed through the water of the Word, and Yeshua is the Word made flesh, John 1:14. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. The Word was with God. That's why it says in Isaiah 12, God is our Yeshua. He's saying this and no one is catching this, but he is giving out and projecting the most amazing prophetic significance upon the water libation ceremony, and specifically the water of the pool of Siloam that's cleansing all of them. And he's saying, "This is me. I am that water, but come to me and drink and you'll never have to go through that water or drink ever again." Amen. To me, that's amazing. All right, but we're not done yet. There's so much more to this water libation ceremony and the Feast of Sukkot. So let's go back to our PowerPoint here. Inside the courtyard of the Temple Mount area, they erected a massive, and I'm talking about a huge candelabra that was multi-stories high. It held tens of gallons of fuel, of oil. And then catch this, they had four wicks that came out of this of the oil of this candelabra. It was so bright, they said it would light up courtyards 6 miles away in Bethlehem. That's how bright this giant candelabra was in the temple courtyard. Now, here's what's significant about this. I just glossed right over it. But the oil that was placed in there, okay, was made in Bethlehem, number one, and like the other oil that was in the temple. And the wicks, you know what the wicks were made out of? The wicks were made out of the high priestly garments from the previous year. They would take the high priest's garment, they would tear it into four different pieces, and they would use it as wicks representative of the four corners of the earth, that the high priest was represented in all four corners of the earth. That's why there were four. Now, here's what's absolutely mind-blowing is when you go to John chapter 19, on the day that Yeshua dies and literally is erected as the light of the world, you know, although it got dark and no one knew it, that he was the true spiritual light of the world, look what happens. John chapter 19, verse 23 says this, "Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts." They tore it into four parts, to each soldier a part, and also the tunic. Now, the tunic was without seam, woven from top in one piece, so they didn't rip that. They sold that. You see, in the high priestly garment, there's two parts. There is the outer part, which is the part that they ripped into four, and then there is the tunic, and the tunic is the spiritual element, and it cannot be torn. It doesn't even have a seam. They wove it from top to bottom. I don't even know how they do it. I don't even think they do that today. Absolutely incredible. There's not even a single seam. So the point is that they tore his garment into four exactly like the garment from the high priest that they would tear into four pieces and use them as wicks. Yeshua was the light of the world, and this is another hidden gem that God put right into the scriptures for those that would study to show themselves approved, that would know his feast days and the Hebraic culture of the first century, of the authors that wrote what we call scripture. If we would know and study to show ourselves approved, we would have appreciation for this on a higher level, my friends. This deepens our faith. This isn't just knowledge for knowledge's sake. This deepens our faith and it humbles us. It should humble us to realize how much he put in to the death, burial, and resurrection of his son. And what we've learned our whole life is Jesus died, he was buried, he rose from the dead 3 days later. But the significance and the matrix of dominoes that had to take place on so many levels for this to all fall like Tetris, in perfect harmony. Look at this. Even the soldiers are tearing his robe and they have no idea that they're being manipulated by angels and by the Holy Spirit himself to do so. How many times? Don't tell me that God don't use pagans. He used pagan kings to get Israel where they needed to be. He used a pagan king to allow Nehemiah to come back and rebuild Jerusalem. He uses pagan kings to chastise, and he used pagans here, the very ones that probably killed Yeshua and hammered the nails into his hands. He used them to fulfill prophecy. That's amazing. All right, let's keep going. That is the water libation ceremony, and every year we do something similar at our Sukkot. We do our best to honor and remember that by going down to the lake at the Christian camp that we're at, dipping water out of the lake and pouring it out as a drink offering at the bonfire. And then we're all dancing and worshiping the Lord. It's an amazing time. But let's go to Matthew chapter 17 and see another prophetic hint to the Feast of Tabernacles. Read it with me. "Now, after 6 days, Yeshua took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. He turned into his glorified state. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. Then Peter answered and said to Jesus, 'Lord, it's good for us to be here. If you wish, let us make here 3 tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah.'" Now, what is he saying here? In the Hebrew, he would have said, "Let us make a sukkah for each one of you." Now, either he knew the prophetic significance or it's the season of tabernacles, because you don't make a sukkah for any other time. This is the time where everyone would make sukkahs. It was in the fall during the Feast of Tabernacles, temporary dwelling place. This is why we go out and we camp in our RV or in a motel, or some people tent. Some people stay in a lodge or a cabin. Everybody together is in a temporary dwelling place, recognizing that we are the temporary dwelling place of God, and this earth is not our home. That's the beauty behind it. So some people say, oh, you're in bondage for following the Feast of Sukkot. No, we are not in bondage. We are having more fun than you can possibly imagine. And the depth that our kids are learning when we teach them that, look, this home is that we live in is not our real home. This here is not our real home. And for 8 straight days, we're worshiping God. They're learning, and they're learning all about eternity, looking forward to eternity. That's what's permanent. Getting our lives straight and worshiping him now, that's what it's all about. And so I believe that this was during the Feast of Tabernacles, and that's another prophetic hint. Now, let's go to Revelation chapter 22, and we're going to close out this broadcast today, my friends, a little bit early. But let's read this and put this all in perspective for how we can operate today. Revelation chapter 22, verse 14 and 17 says this: "Blessed are those who do his commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter through the gates into his city. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let him who hears say, come. And let him who thirsts," you hear that? Thirst, "come. Whoever desires, let him take the water of life freely." This is a direct connection to the water libation ceremony and the Feast of Tabernacles. This is very clearly referencing the marriage supper of the Lamb. John on the island of Patmos, he knows what's going on. Yeshua speaking through him is saying, "Blessed are those who keep his commandments." My friends, when he wrote this, there is no New Testament. There's only one set of commandments in the Bible, and that's right out of the Torah. The very commandments that the enemy has manipulated the Roman church and thus the Protestant church to believe that God did away with his own commandments. Even though John, the same John in 1 John chapter 5 says, "Here are those who love God, those who keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome." Paul said in Romans chapter 7, the very thing he wanted to do that he couldn't do, but he wanted to, was keep the commandments. He says, "With my mind, I'm subject to the law of God, but I find another law inside of me, the law of sin and death." He wants to keep the commandments. That's why he says in Romans 3:31, is the commandments done away with? Is the law done away with just because Christ came, because faith came? "May it never be. I uphold the law," he says. He's a law keeper, not a law breaker. And that's why James says in his own book, "Don't be a hearer of the word, be a doer of the word." And again, there is no other word when he wrote that than the Hebrew scriptures, what we call the Old Testament. So my friends, this is a beautiful thing. That's why he says, those who have ears to hear, the Spirit says, come, join with me. Join with me on the Feast of Tabernacles. Join with me in the water libation ceremony. Reenact this. Look forward to the full fulfillment of this at the end of time when the marriage supper of the Lamb comes and we're all sitting at his table. So as we close this out, I just want to encourage you to look into these feasts. They will transform your life and your family faster than you can imagine. These are prophetic. They're never ending. This is why in Zechariah chapter 14, it says in the millennium that Yeshua is going to come back on the Mount of Olives. He's going to split it in two. The law is going to go out from him. And then anyone that doesn't come up for the Feast of Tabernacles, he's going to cut off rain from their country, from their land. My friends, that's in the millennium. We're commanded to do this. Why? It's not out of obligation. Only it's because God wants to bless us. He wants us to remember what happened on the cross. He wants us to remember by doing, not remember by remembering, but remember by doing. This is why when you have an anniversary or a birthday that comes up, you celebrate it. You don't just go through it. You do something to honor that person. You buy them a gift. You take them out to dinner. You honor them. That's what these feast days are all about. It's honoring the first and second comings of Messiah. And I encourage you to look more into it. If you'd like more information on our Sukkot, you can go to passionfortabernacles.com. And each and every year we do this, and we open it up for anyone in the world that would like to come. If not, you can celebrate it in your home, in your backyard, erect a tent in your backyard, barbecue every night, read the scriptures, eat under your sukkah, do homework or do research. It will bless you. Read the scriptures and let God minister to you and wash you clean. If you've never done it before, it's an absolutely eye-opening thing, and your family and your kids will love it. All right, until our next Sukkot, which at the making of this video is within a week from now, we will see you in the next video. Shalom, shalom, my friends, and thank you for spending time with us here at Passion for Truth.